Hello everyone, welcome to our ENS webinar on microreactor technology applications with our corporate member Westinghouse Electric Company. And we have a pleasure today to have a great speaker with us, Dr. Fausto Franceschini, who is consulting engineer at Westinghouse Mangiarotti. And he made decisive contribution and provided leadership to many critical projects related to advanced reactor design, advanced fuels and cycles, and reactor physics methods development and validation. He is a pioneer in the core physics and economic analysis of Westinghouse accident tolerant fuels. He has over 100 published papers, 2 books, and 5 best paper awards. He was a keynote speaker in many seminars and conferences. And I think what's important is to say that he's also a prominent contributor to the Westinghouse Lead Fast Reactor Program and the eVinci Micro Reactor Program in the areas of fuel and core design. Fausto, welcome.
Hi, Emilia. Thanks a lot.
Please, the floor is yours.
Okay, thanks. So let me share my screen and let me know if there is some issue with sharing the content. Okay, so today I'm going to talk about microreactors. Let me try to move some icons out of the way. And as Emilia introduced me kindly, I'm a consulting engineer at Westinghouse Mangiarotti and also working with the headquarters at Westinghouse Electric Company. So let me page through the slides and give you an overview of the contents first. So first we'll discuss what are microreactors. We'll take a look at the potential applications of microreactors, which are different than traditional reactors. Then I try to provide an overview of what technology options exist out there for microreactors. And then I'll talk about some common issues for microreactors in particular, which are related to transportation, manufacturing, economics, and then I will come to the conclusions and then we'll open the floor for questions.
Fausto, maybe to warm up a bit our group, maybe yeah. We ask them first question, if you allow me. So the
yes.
question is, which actually was prepared by Fausto, do you believe that microreactors will effectively contribute to the nuclear? Please select one of the three possible answers. I will give you 15 seconds. Okay, we have 67 answers.
Okay, that's good.
67 answers for yes and only 8% of no, 25 not sure. So maybe just as we have to be sure that our audience is really attentive, we have another question. What do you think is the most promising technology for microreactors? And here you have a bit more options to select: heat pipe microreactors, high temperature gas cooled microreactors, liquid metal cooled microreactors, molten salt microreactor.
Yeah, and I'll be talking about some of these categories in my presentation. So there is some content related to the technology also in the slides.
Okay. The answers are changing, the bars are moving in different ways. Now we have another. Yes, so most of the attendees said that heat pipe microreactors is the most promising technology. Okay,
that's
let's
good to
continue.
Know. Yeah, it's an interesting feedback, thanks. And thanks for your attention, of course. So let me go to the definition of microreactors. Microreactor is designed for using unique applications where energy generation on the order of megawatts is needed, but otherwise unavailable or prohibitively expensive. So they are small reactors. They are usually less than 20 megawatt thermal, and some common features. There are multiple configurations of microreactors. There are stationary and mobile microreactors, and we'll focus more on the stationary microreactors here, where there is more open information available. And then they can operate independently from the electric grid to supply highly resilient power for critical loads under normal and emergency conditions. Some other common features is that they are manufactured and assembled in a factory, and they are easy to transport. And then they are neutronically simple, so to speak, so that it is possible to conceive a semi or fully autonomous operation for these reactor designs. They can make electricity, heat, or both, of course. Some key benefits of microreactors, and these are peculiar to microreactors. I'm not going over, nuclear energy against other energy sources. They are highly resilient and reliable, and this is due to the simplicity and the presence of no, no, you know, the absence of moving parts in the reactor designs, absence or minimal presence. They rely usually on passive safety to a large extent, and they have a long core life, which with the highly reliable power conversion systems enable to have a higher availability factor for the reactor. They have a low footprint and they are environmentally benign. This is true also for the nuclear energy in general, but the peculiarity here is that they are very small, so they can be co-located in close proximity to the end user due to the small footprint. Now, of course, there are other issues, but the radioactivity source is small, and then the reactor footprint is small, so it is possible to conceive to put them closer to the end user. They are flexible in terms of power generation and load following, and they can it is easier to integrate them with the renewables and other intermittent energy sources. They can make electricity and heat. You can use the heat for desalination, water purification, district heating, and so on. And they are simple and safe. They are simple because they are smaller, and there is a higher reliance on inherent level of safety and security. And then there are, of course, incorporation of the latest advancement in technology for these reactors. And again, many designs are semi-autonomous, so that they require very few human operators on the site. Fast on-site installation is another very peculiar feature. Contrary to big reactors, these reactors, they are usually manufactured and assembled on a factory line, and they are shipped to the end user for deployment, so can be quick connected to the grid in this case. So potential applications. There are three or four key potential applications. One is for remote communities that usually rely on diesel generator. You can glean from the images how difficult it is to transport the diesels in some of these zones. Sometimes weather conditions will not even allow to transport diesels. So the diesel is very expensive, and the cost of electricity is very expensive in these regions. And they can certainly use a reliable energy source that doesn't need fuel to be transported on site very often, and it is highly available for making electricity or other sources of energy. Another application is in case there is a natural disaster which disrupts the grid or prolong the absence of the grid to the population. It can provide backup power for extended periods of time. You can see what happened there in Puerto Rico, one of the latest hurricanes striking Puerto Rico. This is certainly an occasion where a microreactor deployed on site would have helped with getting the power back to the people quicker. Microreactors in a world where decentralized energy production is increasing compared to centralized energy production, they can play an important role. They can be integrated in a microgrid, and they can provide energy with the features of an autonomous battery type reactor, meeting the complete needs of the customer. So they can make electricity, they can make heat, and they can use the electricity and the heat for different purposes. Other application is for so-called special purpose customer, where that put high value on reliability of resilient energy sources for a long period of time. One example are military bases, and in this case, according to where the military base is located, the transportation of the reactor is, becomes even more important. The easier transportation of the reactor, transportation, removal, and so on. So let me describe what are the technology options for that. When you try to categorize reactors, there are always shortcomings. So I apologize in advance if I missed some categories or I try to lump, too much the categories. But practically, I can see that there are four micro reactor types. First one is heat pipe reactors. These reactors, they typically use sodium or potassium or sodium-potassium heat pipes. The fluid moves in the heat pipes with a capillary motion, doesn't require pumps or other moving parts to move the fluid around. And they are typically passive self-regulating devices, these heat pipes. They can operate in a fast or epithermal spectrum, and this is the typical operation for these reactors, either fast or epithermal. Another reactor type is a high temperature gas reactor. In this reactor, usually a forced circulation of helium provides the coolant capabilities. There can be a direct or indirect cycle in this case, and the fuel is typically TRISO, so it is this kernel of UO2 or uranium carbide with surrounded by layers of graphite and silicon carbide. They are typically thermal spectrum reactors. The TRISO fuel guarantees another level of protection against the release of fission products, so they are pretty resilient from this viewpoint. And you can, of course, conceive also to put TRISO fuel in the heat pipe reactor. Then two other reactor types, one is based on liquid metal. As you know, if you use liquid metal, you don't have a pressurized system, so or at least on the primary side. So the benefit here is that it is a low pressure system. It's usually fast reactor in this case. If the coolant is sodium, then there is lower corrosion concerns in case the liquid is lead or lead bismuth. But there is the concern of boiling, and then there is the concern of the reaction with sodium, between sodium, air, water, and supercritical CO2. Whereas if you have a heavy liquid metal, then it is possible to eliminate the intermediate circuit and to compare the reactor even more due to the lead having benign reactions with air, water, and supercritical CO2. Molten salt reactor, they are based on salt, removing the heat. The salt can be chlorine or fluoride. There are different behavior or different types of fuel for these two cases. The fuel can actually be circulating or not. These reactors, they make a lot of tritium usually, so they require intermediate heat exchanger between the primary and the secondary, and the power conversion system, which is detrimental to compactness. And here I show in an example of a heat pipe reactor. This is the one that Westinghouse is developing. It's called the Vinci. You can read the features in the top of this slide. But practically, it is the monolith. It is disposed horizontally to produce energy. There is a central monolith. It's usually a solid block. And then there are holes where the fuel and the heat pipes are contained. You can still see the heat pipes sticking out of the monolith. The heat pipes, they collect heat from the core. There is a sodium or sodium potassium or potassium inside. The fluid boils and eventually condenses in the heat exchangers, and through capillary motion it comes back from the wick and begins again, returns to the core, then it evaporates again. There is again no need to move the fuel around with pumps, which is a great advantage of these reactors. You can see that there is an emergency shutdown. This is a passive shutdown system, and then there is an active shutdown, the activity control system, which is provided by the control drums surrounding the core. Reactor control, when you keep in mind that there is the desire to minimize the personnel on site, then you can glimpse at what common features there should be from the reactor control viewpoint. So practically there is the goal or the desire for microreactor developers to rely on inherently safe, self-regulating devices with a minimum number of components and limited need for maintenance. And this, of course, also increases reliability beside allowing a minimal amount of operators on the site. So practically, we rely on natural means to control reactivity, like reactivity feedback effects. These are classic feedbacks, also in large reactors, but some of these feedbacks, they are stronger due to the small size of the reactor. For instance, the thermal expansion is much more important in a small reactor than a large reactor, of course. Then we rely on advanced cooling methods like the heat pipes that you saw to increase self-regulation in the reactors. And then there are active methods, of course, like the reactivity control drums. Load following is an important feature in microreactors. Also, large reactors, they can load follow, but these reactors, they have a larger span of load following that they can achieve. And again, it is achieved through a combination of feedback effects and active controlled. Another peculiar aspect of microreactors is the core. So the core is usually smaller than in other reactor designs. It is smaller because of the smaller power, of course. The power density is not necessarily smaller. It is not necessarily higher than compared to the traditional cores. The power density is actually smaller in these reactor designs. And this makes it easier to achieve a long cycle length. Actually, the cycle length that microreactors target is between 3 and 10 years, according to the reactor design and the fuel type. And they are typically single batch designs. This means that the fuel is all discharged from the core at the same time. So there is a it is once through fuel, and it is loaded initially and then discharged after 3 or 10 years all simultaneously. If we have a fast spectrum or epithermal spectrum design, then it is easier to achieve a smaller reactivity swing, a smaller difference in reactivity between during the cycle. And that makes it easier to achieve long cycle lengths. So if you look at microreactor designs, fast or thermal or epithermal, they feature usually a longer cycle length than the other reactor designs, than the thermal reactor designs. And then there is for the heat pipe designs, the core is solid, is a solid block. And this design allows to reduce the complexity and increase reliability of the components, which again facilitates making the cycle length longer. In terms of fuel options, the microreactors can be very flexible, so there is a variety of fuels that they can utilize. I made the example of the heat pipe reactors. We looked at UO2, uranium silicide, MOX, moly fuel, and TRISO fuel. And they are all possible with different performance, of course, but they are all possible within this reactor design. The benefit of TRISO, again, it is resistant to high temperature. And the fission products, they have additional barriers to go through before being released. So it is a very safe fuel from this viewpoint. One common issue of microreactors, or many microreactor designs, is that often they use low-enriched high-assay uranium. So fuel is U-235 enrichment is between is higher than 5, below 20%. And the challenge here is that there is no commercial infrastructure currently to produce and transport this fuel. So this is a common challenge that all microreactor developers will need to overcome if they want to deploy the reactor on time. But finally, the fuel selection is based on the reactor application and the components and the materials surrounding the fuel. So the fuel has to be compatible with the materials that are adjacent to the fuel. Shutdown mechanisms, how do we shut the reactors down? There are inherent safety feedback, as in other reactors. Again, some of them, they are stronger in microreactor designs. Then there is usually a passive shutdown system activated without INC signals. In this case, we can see the location of a passive shutdown system for the Da Vinci reactor in the center of the monolith. And then there is a, these are the combined with active shut systems, like in this case, the reactor control drums, which are the circles surrounding the core. On one side, they have a reflector material. On the other side, they have an absorber material, and the rotation of the drums can control the reaction. Safety approach is the same, you know, the structure is similar to large reactors. So there are five levels. I took the picture here from IAEA SRS 46 assessment of defense in depth for nuclear power plants. But we have these five levels. So the first one is prevention of abnormal operation and failures. So practically we design the reactor with the applicable codes and standards so that we minimize the occurrence of these abnormal operation instances. If we do have abnormal operation, we need to be able to detect and monitor the operation very carefully, and then there are advanced monitoring techniques that can be used by microreactor designers to do that. In case there is an accident, a design basis accident, we want to be able to shut down the reactor and to remove the decay heat passively. So that's level three. Control of the severe plant conditions, of course, if there is an emergency, we want to minimize the consequences of that event. And then in case we have radiological consequences, we need to be able to mitigate those consequences with the procedures and plans for response. Now, we need to point out that the source term for microreactors is much smaller than for large reactors. So it is easier to achieve level five control and mitigation in this case. The decay heat removal is most often occurs with exchanging heat ultimately with air. So air is the ultimate heat sink. Many microreactor designs. You can see the example here. I took it from Avinci. There is a chimney where the hot air can go out from the canister, and then there are inlets ports for the cold air to come through, and then there is natural circulation of air inside the reactor and around the reactor canister, which guarantees that the decay heat can be removed. And again, air is the ultimate heat sink, so it's wild, you know, broadly abundant, and can be used in every location. Moving out of, you know, from the primary system or the core, then there is another issue or another interesting features of microreactors is the power conversion system. There are typical goals, which are to have a simple system which requires no or little maintenance to, again, having a high reliability. Efficiency is an issue when you go to smaller size, especially for traditional power conversion cycles. And then we want the power conversion power conversion system to be compact, because we want, again, to be able to transport the reactors, possibly integrated with the rest of the reactor design, and then to minimize the points where we can have leaks that needs to be sealed and so on. Technology options, the Rankine cycle is usually not used in microreactors. The prevalent options, they are Brayton cycle organic Rankine cycle, which can be a bottoming cycle in some of these options. And then we have supercritical CO2 and free piston Stirling engines. These are two emerging technologies for microreactors, which are very promising. For instance, supercritical CO2 has usually a low TRL for a technology readiness level for large reactors, because it has been prototyped only on a small power scale. But this small power scale is actually the microreactor design power. So it's not typical anymore for these microreactor designs and supercritical CO2 due to the compactness that can bring to the power conversion system, to the turbines and so on. Is actually a very, very promising power conversion system for microreactors, which can reach efficiency over 30%. On the smallest microreactor side, another promising option is the free piston Stirling engines, because they are simple and modular. They can have a high efficiency, even at small sizes. They can run for tens of thousands of hours between maintenance, and they are quiet. They have been used in submarines, in the Swedish submarines, I believe. So for all these features, this is also a very promising power conversion technology for microreactors. Another important area for microreactors is the manufacturing. It is usually targeted to make these reactors on a factory line. So we want to maximize the in-factory fabrication, because the more fabrication occurs in the factory, then it is easier to deploy the reactor rapidly and to transport it rapidly. Construction times on sites, they are minimized, and the related costs. By being able to control the process, the manufacturing process more accurately in a factory, then the reliability improves, and the standardization is easier to achieve. And it is also a shorter learning curve, and it is a quicker turnaround of components and so on. So it is more practical to incorporate lessons learned in the manufacturing of these reactors if we make the reactors in a factory. Now, something to point out is that sometimes the microreactor developers, they express the desire to fuel the reactor also on the in the factory, and then to ship it assembled on the site. In this case, then there are criticality. There is criticality prevention that needs to occur in the factory, which eventually becomes a Class A facility with the related challenges. And then advanced manufacturing techniques, which are promising in general for reactors, but they expect to play an even more important role for microreactors for making a smaller reactor components, which there is plenty of course. How do we transport microreactors? There are three main ways to transport them, and I provided pictures with examples. Each one of them, of course, we are not transporting microreactors in this case, but fuel. But one is air transport, one is land transport, which can happen in rail or roads, and then sea transport. And there are different challenges related to each one of these means of transportation, and some of the accidents that can occur during one of these means of transportation, they are more limiting in one scenario after the other. Just to make an example, for air transport, for instance, the impact in case of fall of the plane or of the container with the plane is much more limiting than in other scenarios. So it is a challenge, but there are ways around it. So what are the challenges? The challenge is that the microreactor developers, they need to come up with an appropriate transportation strategy to reach remote communities. We saw that so these communities, they are in the Arctic region, so they are difficult to reach with the standard means. And then they need to be rapidly deployed on site. So we don't want to transport a fully disassembled reactor on site and then to have to assemble it on site, because that's it's a loss of time. Again, often microreactor developers, the they have the goal of transporting the fuel and the reactor together to the deployment site. So from this viewpoint, the transportation of microreactors is kind of similar to fuel transportation, and the containers to transport microreactors, they can look pretty much like a canister for spent fuel. And I put a picture in the slide there. You can see that there's an impact limiter on the right, for instance, of the canister. Now, of course, if a canister needs to be used, then it has to be licensed in the on a schedule which is compatible with the deployment time of the microreactors. And there are different casks. Some of them, they are very large. They can fit a microreactor or not, depending on the size of the microreactor. The alternative, of course, is to develop a customized cask for the microreactor design, or to integrate the microreactor with the cask. This is also an advanced solution for transporting microreactors. Let me then move on the economics. Now, economics is important because it's really, you can have the most beautiful technology around, but if there is no business case for the technology, then there is no reactor being ordered. Traditionally, large reactors, they are favored because of the economy of scale. So there is a large fraction of the total cost which is due to fixed costs. They don't change according to the reactor size, or they only mildly change according to the reactor size. So the bigger the reactor size, the more we can spread these costs over a large power rating, and then the LCOE becomes better. Now, of course, there are drawbacks. So the initial investment in large reactors is pretty considerable, and it is due to the complexity of the construction. It is possible, or actually likely, that there will be delays which will penalize economics, and we learned the lessons in the recent bills in the nuclear area. Economics of microreactors, they don't rely on the economy of scale, of course, but they can rely on different things. First of all, design simplification. If the design is simpler, then it is often cheaper to manufacture it. Again, factory manufacturing is another aspect that can favor economics. Economy of scale in production, we make large volumes of the same piece versus making fewer pieces for a limited number of plants. Learning cycle is shorter for microreactors. There is a shorter construction time and minimal on-site construction. And these are all aspects that benefit economics. Now, it is difficult to conceive that microreactors will ever compete economically with large reactors, even though this is possible, of course, in the long run. But what they need really to do is that they don't necessarily need to compete with large reactors. They need to compete with alternative energy sources in the places where they are intended for deployment. And these alternative energy sources, they are usually very expensive. So the microreactors, as long as they have a reasonable economy, they can penetrate these markets and make a difference. Here I'm showing a plot from an NEI, Nuclear Energy Institute, technical report on cost of competitiveness of stationary microreactors for enduring locations. It's a very nice read that I recommend to everybody. But so practically they are plotting here the levelized cost of electricity on the left axis, and then the number of microreactors deployed on the primary x axis. There are different deployment sites, the remote Arctic communities, the defense stations, island communities, Alaska Rail Belt, and US grid. And there are three cost scenarios: high cost, moderate cost, and low cost. You can see that according to the cost, they can, the options with lower costs, they can penetrate the respective markets more easily compared to the high cost scenarios. But there is the option to penetrate some of these markets in all cost scenarios. And actually, you can see that as the number of reactors are divided, you can see the trend in the learning curve that decreases as COE make these reactors more appealing quickly as they are, the more the reactors they are deployed. And finally, let me talk about the deployment schedule. So there is a for large reactors, we start with the schedule and then we often multiply the schedule by two because something occurs and then it takes much longer to build them than we thought it would. For micro reactors, we are incorporating lessons learned from the past builds, of course, but we also take advantage of some features of micro reactors, features which allow for shorter construction times. So they are simpler, smaller size, and so on. And here I'm tabulating, again, taking this information from the NEI report, a different one, and tabulating different activities and then a nominal schedule for these activities to take place, and then an accelerated schedule for these activities. Some of these activities they can overlap with each other, so you don't need to add, but to add these years to obtain the total. But practically, the accelerated scenario allows, forecasts to have these reactors deployed in 5 years. So and the nominal scenario it is 7 years. So I think it is reasonable to assume that by the mid-20s, these reactors will be online, which is an aggressive target, yes, but it is also increasing our hopes that during one's career they can see some new reactors built and demonstrate and operating. So it is I think it is exciting news for the nuclear people that there is a new reactor technology that can be deployed in a reasonable amount of time. And finally, let me go to the conclusions. So micro reactors, they are not yet deployed, but they are a reality. We are aggressively pursuing them to address the needs of a variety of customers. Again, remote communities rely on expensive diesel for energy generation, remote mining industry, that's another option too, backup power for emergency conditions, military applications, and so on. What I try to cover in this presentation is to give you a broad overview of some key features and potential applications of microreactors so that you can have some general top-level information on this technology, and hopefully you can get excited as we are on this new technology option. Having said that, I want to thank you for your attention, and I'll return the floor to Emilia, and then I'll be glad to answer two questions if you have some.
Thank you very much, Fausto. It was really inspiring to see the new technologies might come to the market. While we are waiting for the questions, you can put the questions in written, so don't hesitate to put any even tricky questions to Fausto. I'm sure that he will be able to answer. Just to check if you were attentive during the webinar, maybe we go forward with one the question what Fausto was presenting and was proposing. Do you think that the microreactors can achieve viable economics in the targeted markets? Yes and no, please. Okay. Do you see the answers as well, Fausto?
No, how do I do that?
Yes, I will read them aloud. So, 93% for yes and 7% for no.
Wow, we have a very optimistic audience. That's good. I think it's we are tired of depressed nuclear scientists that
Okay, so maybe one more question, and please put the questions. Oh yes, I see some questions already coming. Okay, fantastic. Let me see. So, one question is, do you think enough R&D and support is given to microreactors deployment in the EU? What more could be done to help meet the 2020s deployment?
So I think that microreactors, they
I'm
are
sorry. Yes, this is a let me just see. Okay, now I have the full questions. So the first question is coming from Louis-Philippe Durand. Thank you for the presentation. How does the passive shutdown system work?
Sorry, can you repeat the question,
Yeah.
Miguel?
How does the passive shutdown system work? Shutdown system
Yeah.
work.
Okay. Okay. And then there is the question on R&D.
Ah, yes. So you wanted to answer directly, maybe this question?
Yeah, I can. The passive shutdown system, I think we need to retain that information because it's proprietary. So we don't want to disclose. But
Of course.
practically, I mean the without talking about that system specifically, in general, I think we need to rely on. I am talking obvious things, but we need to rely on self-actuating mechanisms. So in case there is, for instance, a large temperature increase or some pressure differential, then the shutdown system will intervene. But it's again the specifics of the system, they cannot be disclosed at the current time. Going back on the other question,
Yes, so the question was put by Nathan Patterson. Do you think enough R&D and support is given to microreactors deployment in the EU? What
Yeah.
more could be done to help meet the 2020s deployment timeframe? Funding, joint industry strategies, other ways?
It's also a very good question, this one. So given that they are a relatively new technology, I think that the politicians will still need to react to open up funding opportunities for this new reactor technology. In the US, they are becoming increasingly sensitized to microreactors. They are very fashionable now concepts, and the Department of Energy is actually funding different companies to develop microreactors. The Westinghouse, they just got a significant award from DOE to perform R&D on these reactors and to bring it to the market. So there is a increase in funding for this for microreactors, and I think there will be more and more funding opportunities in the short future coming out of the DOE in the US. And if the US is a mirror of what is going on in the rest of the world, then I'm sure that some other countries will follow, or they are already following with the funding opportunities. But of course, it's not only the other, the external entities. It's also the industry that they need to demonstrate that they are serious about it, and they need to make investments. So it's usually a combination of efforts from the politicians and then also
Absolutely.
the industry. And we are actually doing that in Westinghouse, and I'm sure that the other companies that are serious about microreactors, they are doing the same. So they are investing significant resources in promoting this new reactor technology.
Okay, I have a question from Eric Ida Peterson. What does Westinghouse think is necessary for nuclear to successfully compete in conventional non-insulated markets? like for example in the US grid on the figure on the slide of the economics. So yeah, there was the one figure on this.
Yeah, let me go back. I mean, the to compete, if I go back to the slide, just to talk. So you can see where the US market here is in the very bottom. Now the US market is complex because it is a combination of regulated and deregulated market, and the regulated market is more penetrable than the regulated market. Currently, natural gas is pretty low in the US, so it's also difficult to compete for large plants in such a tough market. So to really be able to compete on the grid for everywhere in the US, which I think is the toughest market anywhere. If you trust the numbers from NEI, you can see that we need to be able to make these micro reactors with a low capital cost, low operating costs, so on, the minimum cost scenario that we foresaw, and then we need to make a lot of them so that eventually the lessons learned and the learning curve will allow us to be able to compete with the other sources of electricity, the conventional sources of electricity. There are some features of microreactors which I think they will allow them to reach a better integration with the renewables and so on, so to be able to not only to compete economically but also functionally, to make them a cornerstone of these new microgrids. Again, this will take time, of course. So can they compete with the conventional sources in the US? I think it's tough. I think it will take time, but I don't think it's impossible.
Okay, I have two very active persons who put another a few questions. So maybe I will first unmute Louis-Philippe Durand-Vinoessa. Philippe, Louis, can you put the question directly? Now you are unmuted.
Can you hear me?
Yes, very well.
Hi,
well, I would like to know how important is the expansion feedback reactivity term compared to Doppler or moderator reactivity coefficient for a monolith core design as you have in this kind of reactor?
It is an important component, let me say, because again, the reactor is relatively small, and it is a solid block. So when you expand the block, then there is a significant reactivity effect. How to compare? How does it compare with the Doppler and so on? I don't have the numbers on the top of my head, to be honest with you. But it is an important component. It is as important as you can imagine, due to the small size of the core and the spectrum. Is pretty fast, so that there is a significant migration length for the neutrons so that a change in size is important from a reactivity viewpoint.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Okay,
yeah, you're welcome.
Thank you very much. I have another question from Carlos Vasquez Rodriguez. He put three questions, so maybe Carlos, are you able to put the questions directly, orally, please?
Yes, of course. I would like to know, if you could explain the performance of the control rotating drum and what is it made of for the reactivity control.
Yeah, they are. So I'll tell you what I can say about the drums, but this is probably the best picture to see them. So the core is a. Can you see my pointer, my mouse
Yes.
pointer? Okay, so this is the core, the monolith, with the fuel and the heat pipes, and then surrounding the core, there are these control drums. They rotate and they can offer to the core either one side which has a reflector material. So in case you know the excess activities is minimal, then we can provide reflection capabilities to the core, and then the reactivity increases. And in case we need to remove reactivity from the core, such as for long-term reactivity control, then we rotate the drums from to the opposite side where there is an absorbent material. I think it's B4C. So what happens, you gradually rotate, you start with the drums in offering the absorbent part to the core, and then as the core depletes, you make up for the loss in the activity by rotating the drums towards the reflector side. You know, it's not always all reflector or all absorbent. That can be intermediate positions, of course, where there is an intermediate hold down of reactivity.
Thank you. I understand. Yeah. Okay. Could I make the second question?
Yeah.
Okay. I would like to know how will the reactor be licensed against external events, on which external events will be taken into account for the transport and whatever?
Yeah, this is it's a long answer, but I mean, for transportation, we are looking at. Again, imagine that you are going to transport spent fuel. So we are looking at according, you know, that there are US regulations from the Department of Transportation, and then there are regulations from the DOE regarding the transportation of hazardous material. So we are taking a look to those regulations, and then we are trying to understand what is the best way to proceed, whether it is to design a canister outside, or to integrate the reactor with a canister, or you know, to do something else. But we are looking at all the scenarios where, you know, which are implied in the transportation of fuel. So we need to prevent criticality, of course. We need to prevent to provide a containment for the fuel to remain inside in case of accidents. And then we need to provide enough resilience in case there is a free fall of the container, or in case there is another accident that can damage the container. And then, you know, according to the way we are transporting the container, then there are different requirements on the accidents. But practically, again, it is like it is tantamount to transporting fuel. So the classes of accidents that we are looking at, they are those involving fuel transportation.
Then there are more
you know, for military applications, for instance, there are more requirements on impact from external threats like missiles and so on that need to be accounted for.
Okay, thank you. And yep. The last question is a curiosity, I think. Why the heat pipe reactors are used in fast or epithermal spectrum reactors and not only in thermal spectrum reactors?
Because there is they could be thermal, but the issue with thermal reactor is that then the reactor size becomes very large, and it is also difficult to control reactivity. If it is a thermal spectrum, and you want to have a long core life, then it is more difficult to achieve it, because there is a pretty large reactivity swing in a thermal reactor, which is difficult to control over a long cycle length. So that's why we decided. So the fast reactor is the more compact, but it is also the one that uses the fuel worse. The epithermal reactor, it is a good compromise. It is pretty compact, it uses the fuel decently, and then it provides a long cycle length.
Understood. Thank you so much for your questions, and congrats for the presentation.
Oh, thanks a lot. Thanks for your questions.
Thank you, Carlos. Okay, now we have two, and I would say there are the two last questions. One from Marian Kromar. Marian is asking, can you comment on licensing time and budget needed, since this is a novel reactor design?
Oh, the budget. Hi, Marian. He's a personal friend, so just wanted to say hi. The deployment time, there is a, I was, you know, I would go back to the slide with the deployment times here. For the eVinci reactor, I think we are targeting 2025 as the deployment time, but I'm not fully sure. But the deployment time is again between 5 and 7 years, and this is according to, you know, how optimistic of a type you are in deploying a new technology. Regarding the budget, you know, I don't want to dance the line or cross the line of what I could say or what I could not say. So I would refrain from commenting on the budget that is needed, but it is, of course, you know, 10 million, but even billions. So it's much more modest than developing a large reactor. Even though there are some costs, they are unavoidable, and they are probably very similar, like the licensing costs and so on. Some other costs, they are significantly reduced, and some other times they are significantly reduced. So that's where the benefits can materialize for micro reactors.
Okay, and the last question is coming once again from Louis-Philippe about transport. Which measures are implemented to prevent criticality accidents during transport? Is it enough with the active shutdown system reflectors phase to the core, or the fuel charge is then the modified in the final place of installation?
Yeah, it depends on the fuel. Yeah, it is actually very fuel dependent in the sense that depends on the enrichment and the type of fuel and the spectrum test or thermal. But practically, if those measures, it's a very good question, of course, but if those measures are not sufficient, then we need to include burnable absorbers in the fuel. So there are some locations, or there could be some locations. I'm talking in general, not specifically for eVinci, but you know, locking the control drums in an inserted position and maybe removing the reflector is not enough, then we need to make provisions or some locations to contain burnable absorbers that are inserted in the core during transportation, and then they are removed from after the transportation is done when the reactor is deployed.
Okay, we have 2 minutes to go. There is the last question coming from Eric. I think it's a very interesting one. Who will be the reactor operating in isolated communities, mining sites?
The miners. you know, who will be the reactor operators?
Yeah, in isolated communities, the slash, yeah, and then the mining sites, for example.
Yeah, I'm afraid I don't have a good answer, meaning that, you know, I think that the reactor operators they can be minimal. They can control more than one reactor at a time, possibly. They can operate from a remote location, so they don't necessarily have to belong to the community where the reactor is. Meaning that can be, you know, they can operate and control the reactor from a remote location. So I don't see why they should be different than in other reactor locations. I mean, there will be minimal amounts of operators again, and if it is possible, then one reactor operator controlling from a control room remotely more than one reactor, that's also an option.
Okay. Thank you very much, Fausto, for the very interesting presentation. We will send you, if you allow us, the record of the webinar. We will send you a link to the record Well, we will send you after in the next 2 days. It will be placed on our YouTube channel. Yeah, stay tuned because we are planning to have a very interesting coming webinars in the next month. It will be probably also one of the new design of new technology of developing now. Yeah, so follow us please on the LinkedIn website, follow us on Twitter, and you will find all the information there. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Emilia. Thanks, everybody. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you. Have a nice day.
Thanks. You too. Bye-bye.